Meteorologist Dave Baker, along with meteorologist Daniel Phillips, as we come to the end of the 2018 hurricane season. It was certainly a busy one where we had an above normal season, 15 total named storms, 8 hurricanes, 2 of those major hurricanes. Above average for the total storms and the hurricanes, a little below normal when it came to the major hurricanes, but quite a bit of damage, some big numbers. We're about the preseason storm. We had Alberto, which was another one since 2012, only 2014. We didn't have a preseason storm. And some of the forecasts were spot on this year.
Yeah, looking at some of these numbers, and when these come out, they get a lot of media attention. People, they're all over Facebook, they're all over social media. We certainly cover them. But, you know, they're kind of dubious, but the CSU, Colorado State University, Dr. Klotzba there, who does a really good job, 14 named stormed, seven hurricanes, 3 major storms were his forecasts. We're kind of
so he was spot on, yeah. And then NOAA, of course, makes a little bit bigger of a range when they do it, but then they update it in the mid part of the season.
Yeah, so, and that's kind of what's crazy when you think about, you know, we had a pretty active year, but it was weirdly active because we had long quiet periods. It took a little while to get going. And then you have the midseason outlook that comes out again. And a lot of people dropped their numbers. NOAA dropped it big time. They went from 10 to 16 storms in May. And by August 9, NOAA was calling for only 9 to 13. And in August, we hadn't really had anything.
No, in fact, this August was one of the years where we didn't have any hurricanes formed, the first time since 2013, and only 8 other times in recorded history did we not have a hurricane. Now, a lot of that was due, we had some stronger winds, we had some lower sea surface temperatures for a while, Saharan dust was another factor, and you were talking about fires were also an issue.
Yeah, fire was a big thing this year, and if you remember back, certainly over the summer, July, August timeframe, all those fires that were going on in California, the way that weather pattern set up, we had a lot of smoke that had filtered down in the Gulf of Mexico. And you're not with smoke and dust and stuff, you're never going to get anything going. And that's kind of what we saw through the heart of the season. Traditionally, when we're looking to see things ramp up, it was pretty quiet after a couple false starts.
One of the other things that was coming into consideration, too, is there was a forecast that we were going to have an El Nino develop sometime during the peak of the hurricane season, which really ended up being kind of negligible, so that wasn't really a big factor. But getting back to the preseason stuff, it's certainly not that unusual to have a tropical system develop during the month of May or even going into December. In fact, over the past 20 years, we've had 20 named systems that have occurred, or tropical systems rather, that have occurred outside of what the typical June 1st to November 30th hurricane season would be. This year, of course, Tropical Storm Alberto, this was one of our near misses coming into Florida.
Yeah, and that's, and I don't like to put a lot of stock into preseason storms. You know, everyone, and when it gets going in May, everyone thinks, oh man, this has to be a sign of things to come. And I think it's natural, and there's some part of you that thinks, well, man, if it's kicking around already, what does the rest of the summer have to hold? But you're right. They've been going earlier the last few years, the Pacific season. They start their season sort of mid-May, which mm-hmm. It would have fallen right around there at the end of May. We don't start ours till June 1st. But we had a couple things that happened at the beginning of the season that made it look like this might actually be a pretty busy one.
Now, this one made landfall in Laguna Beach, Florida, which is over closer to Panama City, made landfall with 45 mile per hour winds May 28th, but it peaked at 65 miles per hour and, believe it or not, put down about $125 million worth of damage and also killed 18 people, which is pretty unusual for a tropical storm, a minor tropical storm,
right,
is what we would consider.
And it goes to show, I mean, we talk about every year how all of these storms need to be taken seriously. And a lot of people do, to their credit, especially, you know, some of the old timers who know what these things can do. But to think that there was a storm that we don't really talk about much anymore, still producing that kind of damage, still having fatality numbers. Mm-hmm. But when you look back, you'd be hard pressed to go back and find coverage of Alberto other than it's early.
Right. Now, we moved along. We got into July and we ended up with Hurricane Beryl, which was the second earliest hurricane in the central and eastern portion of the Atlantic. This was more like a Cape Verde type of system that we would normally think about maybe late August, September.
And this is what I was talking about when I said that it seemed like there were a couple of false starts. The first one, Alberto going early. And like I said, you don't like to put a lot of stock, but those Cape Verde systems usually kind of indicate that things are starting to kick on. Mm-hmm. So as a forecaster, when you start seeing that, you just think, all right, well, here we go. You know, we got to start building those tropical models into everyday part of forecasting and not just look what from time to time when you think there might be something out there. It's time to get a little more serious with forecasting that. And there was Beryl, and then it got quiet again.
Yeah, and Beryl was one of those that, you know, got a lot of people nervous because it came out of the Atlantic and headed right for the northern Caribbean areas that were just absolutely devastated in 2017. But then it just kind of curled up the East Coast and really negligible on the damage, and fortunately, no deaths. Chris was the next one. It was a Category 2 hurricane. That one starting to come up a little bit later on in the season, but it was actually still going on in July 6th through the 12th, kind of developed around Bermuda, threatened the Carolinas a bit, and then kind of rode up the East Coast. It peaked out at 105 mile per hour wind, so a little bit stronger, but there was one death in the Outer Banks of North Carolina, somebody getting caught up in a rip current, and that may have been when the system was far away. Those rip currents can really be a mess for areas that aren't really close to the system.
Yeah, which goes to show, you know, even when you have some of these storms that are way out in the Atlantic, such as this, their impacts could be felt, you know, pretty far away. We've had some that kind of skirt up close to the peninsula of Florida, don't actually hit anything, mm-hmm. but you don't want to be swimming, you know, over in Jacksonville. And Chris was one that a lot of meteorologists in the Carolinas, you know, got really nervous about. And then ultimately, I think we're able to be okay. And other than some of the rip current issues, but that was over a holiday weekend, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was right after the 4th of July there. Then, as you were saying, you know, you have these couple of false starts, things went all quiet again. We had a couple of what we would call forgotten storms, Debbie and Ernesto, both forming out in the middle part of the Atlantic, both of them tropical storms during the month of August. But again, we had no hurricanes during the month of August. And then Hurricane Florence, which was the first big one. And that one was one that had two separate cycles of rapid intensification. Again, kind of a Cape Verde type of system, straight across the Atlantic, heading right over into the Carolinas.
And that was one that, when people say that they're caught off guard by weather systems, Florence was one that there's no claim you can make about that, because you saw Florence crawl across the Atlantic. Mm-hmm. It was day after day after day. And every meteorologist from Boston to Savannah, Georgia, Jacksonville even, were watching, and you just watched this storm grow in size and intensity. And it's like watching a slow motion disaster. And the closer it gets, the anxiety that builds over that time period was really intense. And then Florence, was kind of the start of this conversation that is going on now about how do we classify these things? Mm-hmm. You know, we have the categories one through five, but that's based off of wind. And
right.
Florence, much like Harvey, there's a major wind and storm surge element, but even if the winds dropped right at the end, it was that rainfall, and not even where it made landfall either. Once you start getting in the mountains, that rainfall, serious, and they're still dealing with the ramifications of that.
Yeah, and another good example would be Hurricane Ike back in 2008. It was a Category 2 storm, but it produced Category 4 type of storm surge that we would have expected here along the Gulf Coast. Now, Florence peaked at 140 miles per hour, but it made landfall as a Category 2, and then for a while, and again because it was moving so slow, and then the eye of the hurricane just kind of stayed right on the coast of North Carolina, drifting southward towards South Carolina. Initially, there was a lot of criticism when it came to evacuations and hyping up the storm. But then when it came down to it, the flooding is what really was the devastating part of Florence.
Yeah, and this is one of those things, I think, that over the last few years, especially with Harvey last year, communicating this threat is getting better. And I think more and more of your lay person is starting to mm-hmm. understand it's not just the moment it hits. It's what's going to happen afterwards. And Florence, you know, I have friends who are in that area, and we talked about evacuation before, should they not. And ultimately, after a bit of a struggle, they decided they were going to evacuate. come home after the storm and then have to leave their house again because now the water is coming back. And mm-hmm. so these things can go on for days. And Florence, very similar to the way Harvey was, hung around for a long time. And it wasn't just as a hurricane that it was causing a lot of problems.
And what's really crazy too, I mean, you know, being a meteorologist and being in this business, especially with Hurricane Harvey, when both of us were looking at some of what the models were predicting, 40, 50, 60 inches of rain, still, you're like, no way, this can't right. happen. And those models, of course, verified. And with Florence coming in, it was predicting 20, 30, 40, 50 inches of rain, and it ended up verifying again.
I think when you, for us as well, the 2016 flood and the way that the models yeah. handled that and Harvey, I think there's some more trust being put in there. And you're right, those numbers before the 16 flood, those numbers before Harvey, those numbers before Florence, at first glance, look like outliers and unbelievable. But to their credit, they have you know, kind of shown up and done really well with some of these figures. And Florence was another one where it's almost, you kind of pause for a moment when you see something like that come across your screen.
Do you think this is what we're going to be seeing going into the future as these computer models get more and more accurate? I mean, we've already seen the changes in the models, but even just in the last 3 years where, you know, you would say in 2015, no way this is going to put down 60 inches of rain. Now you're like, okay, maybe it will.
I think so. And I think every time, you know, it verifies for the model, it's going to build in confidence and mm-hmm. it knows what it's picking up. And these models learn from themselves. You know, people are constantly tweaking them and they're constantly trying to toss outliers out. And I think that the more they see this happen, the less likely they are of kind of coming down on some of those numbers when they know 50, 60 inches is possible,
sure.
especially with something like this.
And that one ended up being the wettest hurricane for both North and South Carolina with the records there. With Florence, just to remind you, that one, they're still counting, of course, almost $18 billion in damage and 30 deaths associated with that. Next one that came along was another of our near misses, Tropical
right.
Storm Gordon. But as we, you know, when you start thinking about hurricane season, people are going to go, huh, Gordon?
Right. And that's the thing with these hurricanes. We've seen that firsthand too with Katrina and Rita. But storms do get forgotten. And Gordon was another one. I forecasted this storm. And still, when we were going through and doing the review of this, had to go back and think to myself, oh yeah, Gordon was something that happened. And was another system that moved very quickly through the Gulf of Mexico and another near miss for Louisiana. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, the last few years, we have gotten incredibly lucky with some of these storms.
And this one was only around for 5 days, September 3rd through the 8th, made landfall around Pascagoula, Mississippi, as a 70-mile-per-hour tropical storm, which is right on the borderline of hurricanes. So when you think about that, 5 days, that's not a whole lot of warning for a lot of folks, especially in a vulnerable place like the Gulf Coast of Mississippi and Alabama.
Yeah, and we've seen too, I mean, with Gordon, with Harvey, with Michael, which we will talk about, the ones down in the Gulf of Mexico the last few years have been going from 0 to 60.
Mm-hmm.
They've gone from a thunderstorm to a hurricane almost overnight. And those are some of the bigger named examples, but it's scary when you start to think at how fast they're moving as well and
yeah.
how fast that they can intensify. Kind of limits the window, which means, you know, come June 1st next year, that plan has to be in place. If not earlier, we saw it with Alberto,
absolutely.
But that plan has to be in place because the window of time you have to react can be very short.
Gordon put down $250 million worth of damage and 2 fatalities with that one. Helene, which was more of a European type of system, it started Cape Verde, kind of curved around and went over toward Europe. And then Hurricane Isaac was another classic Cape Verde one that kind of zipped all the way across the Atlantic but then died out in the Caribbean. A couple of more forgotten ones. You have Tropical Storm Joyce. You have a Tropical Depression number 11. Tropical Storm Kurt, which was toward the end of September. And then an interesting one. Hurricane Leslie, which, you know, you've talked about this one a number of times, about how it just went on and on and on.
It was one of those, because you always, you know, need to keep a running count of what storms are doing, where they're going. And it was one of those where you just came in one day and you thought, all right, well, let's put our graphics together. No way Leslie can can stick around. And there she was. And then it became like, all right, time to check in on our old pal Leslie. How are you doing out there? Still just spinning around, strengthening, weakening, strengthening again. It was a bizarre storm.
Now, it peaked at 90 miles per hour, but it was hanging around from September 23rd to October the 13th. So you're talking a good solid three and a half weeks there. And what was interesting about Leslie is after the loop-de-loops that it had done across the Atlantic, then it took aim at Europe, and this one actually going into the Iberian Peninsula over there toward Portugal and Spain. There was a small island there. Madeira had its first tropical storm warning ever issued since we've been keeping records with tropical systems back in 1851. Hurricane Vince was the only one that came anywhere near that one, and that was in 2005. And you know, all of us really talk about 2005 as kind of being the anomaly of all hurricane seasons,
right,
where we went into the Greek alphabet. There were just so many of
them. And out of that, what was that, 20 storms outside of tropical season in 20 years? What was it, four?
I think
happened
four of them,
in 2005
yeah.
alone?
Crazy stuff. Well, then, of course, right after Leslie was the one, you know, and unfortunately, this makes people forget about Florence and the East Coast, but it was Hurricane Michael, and this, again, another near miss for us here on the northern Gulf Coast, and this was just a catastrophic storm.
It was a wild storm to watch as well, because before, I went out of town the weekend before that it was happening, and when I was wrapping everything up before I left, there was a swirl, little thunderstorm cluster out in the Yucatan, and they had put a 10% type chance or something like that. It was really low, and I thought, okay, that's fine. I don't see that.
We'll just watch
the
it fester.
Yeah. When I came in a few days later and sat back down and looked what the forecast had become, it overnight had gone from this thing that is probably not going to be anything to, wow, this might be a tropical storm. Wow, this might be a hurricane. Wow, this looks like it is now going to be a major hurricane. And it happened almost that fast.
Yeah. And it ended up being 155 miles per hour at landfall, which is kind of unusual, too, because we've seen a number of tropical systems that lift across the Gulf. They get huge out in the middle part of the Gulf of Mexico. And then as they start to approach land, especially when you're starting to get here in October, you get those upper level westerlies that start coming in. There's a lot more shear that gets down toward the Gulf Coast. And a lot of times these October systems do tend to fizzle by the time they reach land. I mean, it went from tropical depression to hurricane in a matter of about 3 days, 4 days.
Right.
And we're not talking just hurricane. We're talking category four, solid category four, dissipating on October 12th. So you're only talking about 5 days of forecasting.
And it moved. It moved so incredibly fast, which I think played a lot into it. It took Category 2 storm winds all the way up into Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember because we were watching this as it came in, and there was about an hour or 2 hour period where every 10 minutes we were calling out another wind, you know, 140, 145, and then eventually peaking 155. And they may go in and back it and see, you know, what they can find it and see if it, there were a couple of spots where it might have been a little bit stronger, but that was a horrific storm to forecast. A personal storm for me to forecast as well. Most of you who know me know a lot of my family and friends were all in that area, and a lot of very nervous phone calls, and a lot of, it really kind of put in perspective how condensed that decision time can be made from, okay, here we have a hurricane. What do we need to do? Do we need to get out? And this, I told my parents this and my friends this. I said, this is why you have a plan in place starting June. So when it's get out day, you know where everything is, you know where you're going, and you don't have to make those decisions in real time.
And it's crazy. This is the third strongest when it comes to pressure behind the Labor Day hurricane of 35 and then the Hurricane Camille back in 1969. Something we want to talk about, too, is, you know, a lot of people who don't live along the Gulf Coast or in hurricane-prone areas, they don't realize when you look at a hurricane on a satellite image, it may take up half of the Gulf of Mexico, but these 155 mile per hour winds are in a very, very small area right around it. Because as you were saying, this made landfall in Mexico Beach, which is what, an hour and a half's drive from Pensacola, maybe 2 hours tops.
It's about 2 hours.
Barely tropical storm winds in Pensacola and in portions of Alabama.
And this became a bit of an issue as well. In communicating some of this. I have a friend in Pensacola, and they're very worried about this storm. We don't want to ride this out. You know, if we need to leave, we need to leave. And I had said, you know, I'm looking at the wind field now, and it looks like you may see some tropical storm gusts. But the heavy stuff is so condensed around the eye and in such a narrow area that you're going to do more harm than good being on the road than you will just buckling down in your house. And getting that through to them was really difficult because of the size. And when you see it on the satellite, it spreads out and the clouds are everywhere, and it looks like such a monster. And it was, you know, where the winds were bad, it was an absolute monster. But it's why when you make these decisions, you have to take the whole big picture, and you can't just look at a satellite or look at a cone and think, I'm good or I've got to leave. Because and what could have been the case is, you know, they could have been outside the wind field, but they could have been on that 50, 60 inch rain if that's what it was dumping, you know. And so that's why when you're making these decisions, you have to factor in so many different aspects. You can't just focus on 55 mile an hour winds right at the center. I'm good or I'm bad.
Fortunately, with this particular hurricane, you know, your cone of uncertainty, your forecast track it really didn't wobble a whole lot. I mean, a lot of times you'll see, you know, big swings of where the system's going to go. This one really for 5 days aimed at the Florida panhandle. Right. So those folks knew that this was coming. Now, we did have Nadine and Oscar that came afterward, but neither one of those were much of a big factor. But talking about some of the computer models and the forecast cone and different things like that, I can tell you 25 years ago when I moved to the Gulf Coast that if there was a tropical system in the Gulf of Mexico, that cone was huge. You had tropical storm warnings, hurricane warnings that stretch from Brownsville to Tampa. And we've consistently seen the cone get smaller and smaller and smaller. With the accuracy of the track has been great. There's a huge change, but the accuracy when it comes to intensification is still a really big challenge.
And that is something to remember as well. You cannot get fixated on, well, I looked at the cone on Monday, so I know what it's going to be like on Wednesday type thing, because the intensity does change a lot, and we still really struggle. So much goes into these storms, from winds to sea surface temperature to air temperature to dust from a desert, you know, half a world away. So to figure out exactly how it's going to strengthen, they do the best that they can. And the National Hurricane Center, the way those updates come out, they can change things pretty quickly. And I think they do a very good job balancing these wild swings to making sure that they're consistent and inching up or inching down their messaging. But when it comes to the track, over the years, those tracks have been getting much, much better. And in particular, this season, the European model was on any noticeable hurricane, the European model was so spot on that even when you kind of questioned it as, that looks weird, that doesn't look right, nailed it.
Yeah. Do you think though with the now from year to year, certain models can do better than others. The European was good this year. Do we think that this is going to continue to stay the primary model that we look at, or do we have other models that you might be excited about that are coming along in the future?
There are others that are being worked on. The amount of work that goes into the European model, it'll be hard to catch. They put a lot of money into it. They put a lot of computer power into it and research into it. And they want to stay the premier world model. But that's not to discredit any of the other ones. And a lot, the North American model, the GFS, they all have their own merits. Now, they have been working on the GFS, and they are kind of prototyping a new version of it, GFS FV3 or F3 or some technical name. And that did a lot better than some of the layman's GFS that we were looking at. But they're experimental, so you don't want to put too much stock into it yet. But it was doing better, and there are improvements for some of the other models coming in on the way. I think it will be tough to catch.
Now, some of the bigger national media stuff, you know, we always talk about don't look at the line, don't look at the coordinates of the dots of where the center of the circulation is going to be. You want to look at that cone because we do have those. That's your margin of error. Some national outlets have now taken away the line and just leaving the cone. Do you think that's a good idea? You think that's a bad idea?
I go back and forth on it, to be honest. I understand people fixating on the line mm-hmm. a little too much, and just removing that temptation from them helps out. But you still want to know where it's going to be the worst mm-hmm. and where you're going to center. And with a storm like Michael, that line was, you know, that's where it hit. That was the worst.
That was like having a massive tornado just roll through.
And
just
I'm
constant.
I'm worried that if you remove the line, you introduce the idea of, oh, well, I'm on the fringe of the cone, or I'm in the cone, but I'm on the edge. I don't know. I think it kind of centers people, and people don't like variation too much. And, you know, just, you can look through my inbox. People want to know what is happening, and they don't want to be told about probability.
What could or could not happen.
And that stuff is important, and the cone is very important. I don't want to do away with the cone. I like the line, though, because I think it kind of centers people.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's up to us. It's up to broadcast meteorologists and other meteorologists to communicate, look, this is the uncertainty. This seems to be where the center of it is going.
Communication is one of those things, too, because of the internet, there are so many different sources available to the general public that weren't there 20 years ago. A lot of people just had to depend on what your local meteorologist or even the Weather Channel or national outlets were telling you. But now everybody else can see a lot of the same data that we look at each and every day. How can we communicate to people who say, oh, well, look at this one model? Because a lot of people will pick that one model that hits Vermilion Bay, while all of the other models, when you look at the spaghetti plots, are going somewhere else. But they don't really know how those models work, how they're weighted, what they really mean, what's put into those models. What can we do as meteorologists to kind of rein them in and say, look, you got to focus on the major ones here?
It's difficult because a lot of people are not malicious about it. They just love weather, and they mm-hmm. just love watching these models come in and they studying it and everything. And I never would want to take away, you know, someone's passion for doing something like that. It's up to us to figure out a way to present the information of, yeah, that looks really scary 10 days from now, but
it's 10 days.
It's 10 days. What track record does this model have? Is it, there's some, mm-hmm. the Canadian, famously the last few years, every day there's Category 5 storm in the Gulf of Mexico look at it. And to get through, you know, yes, these models are great, but it's more than just looking at these models. And over the last few years, what I've talked a lot about is, how is your forecasting trending? You can't come in on a Monday morning, look at the forecast for the week, and say, I know everything for the week, and hold to that. Does it look wetter? Does it look drier, hotter, colder? And
you're looking for consistency.
Right, and when it comes to hurricanes in particular, is this thing drifting a particular way? Because mm-hmm. I with a lot of them, you'll see it starts at New Orleans, then it's Pascagoula, then it's Mobile, then it's Pensacola, and then it's Panama City, and then it stays there.
Right.
And so you can build your trends off of that. And that if you're someone who loves to watch models, just pay attention to the trends, and one model does not make a forecast.
And it's a little tough too, because the models that are coming out now, you have some of them that can run 10 up to 16 days out. And, you know, just like here at KATC, we put out a 10-day forecast. When I started, it was 6, then it went to 8, and now we're at 10. But for the most part, anybody who watched your forecast today, and whatever day is at the very end of that 10-day forecast, they're not going to remember 10 days from now what you said it was going to be. And you really don't take a whole lot of stock in what that forecast is. You're just kind of looking at trends. You're pretty certain that whatever that day is on the 10-day forecast, it's not going to be exactly 65 for the high and 40 for the low with a 30% chance for rain.
Right. And the reason for this is, think about all of the stuff that goes into weather.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to monitor and watch everything. And so if you think that tomorrow at 5 o'clock, it's going to be 78 degrees. That 78 degrees at that time frame is going to have an effect on what you think the weather will be the next day.
Sure.
But if it's 75 and it's not quite what you said, then what you think the next day is going to be a little bit off. And then what you projected that day to be like, that projection further down the line, that's a little bit off. And so the first couple days we're pretty good at. But then you start seeing all the variation and, you know.
And so many things can happen.
Exactly.
I mean, just a general line of thunderstorms developing in Oklahoma can have a drastic impact on your forecast in Louisiana in 2 days.
Right. Yeah. And when, then what becomes tough is about that is now when, during the regular week, that's fine. You know, it's gonna, it becomes rainier on a Friday than we thought it was going to be. Things have changed. That's fine. But the perception of when we see these hurricanes, because what's happening in Oklahoma, that's going to have a big impact on that hurricane in the Gulf of Mexico. And to communicate all of these different things. And
in 2 minutes.
Right. This front has to be here, or it's going to turn this way, or it has to be here, or it's going to go another way. That is, and that's hard. And I think the science is getting better at that. There's more of an acknowledgement of these are the scenarios. I think my expertise says this is the scenario that I think it's going to be, but these other ones are possible. Sure. Instead of just saying, nope, this is it. Trust me, I got it. This is the one.
And I love to tell people too, when they go, oh, did you see that model? It shows that a hurricane's coming in Vermilion Bay in 9 days. I'm like, good. I'm glad it's showing us in 9 days because there's a better chance that it's going to move somewhere else in those 9 days. I'd rather see it on the coast in 9 days than two.
Right.
Because then you're really worried about stuff. So we'll finish off here too. When it comes to the forecasting and trying to communicate a lot of this to the public. And we're not just talking about hurricane season. Now, you know, the fall is typically when the air or the seasons are battling for the geography, you start to get another severe weather season. And of course, winter systems may affect us over the winter. Then we're back into the spring severe weather season. But communication, one of the things that, you know, you and I have talked about over and over again, what we just love to hate, is the social media aspect of trying to communicate to the viewers what they need to know and try to kind of phase out all the junk.
Yeah, and this is a growing problem. And social media, we're going to rag on social media a lot, but there's a lot of merits to it. We can get reports from places that otherwise we wouldn't be able to. When flooding starts happening, we can get a report from someone's backyard that says that creek is running a little bit higher. We may not have a sensor there, and that is valuable information to us. That comes via social media. We can get
pictures and video instantly.
Yeah, and we can get our information out to a lot of people, important information out to a lot of people. What's happening, though, is more and more people are becoming over-reliant on social media to see their information. And you talk to a lot of people and they say, well, I get all my news from Facebook. The problem is that these platforms are starting more and more to restrict what you see on your news feed. So if you like, even if you follow a weather guy, you follow your local weather guys, that's about it. You're not too big into weather, but you love pictures of dogs and you're always liking pictures of dogs and commenting on them. They will keep showing you pictures of dogs. They will not. They will not send to you the hurricane forecast for your area that was typed up that morning because you don't care. They to them, you don't care about it.
And that's the algorithms that work into so that they can better, I guess, earn money off of what social media does. But unfortunately, it's filtering out. So how would the general person, if they know that they're okay? I mean, I look at my Facebook page and I've got several friends and I don't see anything posted. But then I can click on their page and go, wow, they've posted three times in the last 3 days and I never saw it. How can viewers find out that weather information? Do they need to click directly on your page?
Click directly on the page because it's up there and it may not be in your news feed. One last little tangent here. Last year, I wrote a long article. It was about Hurricane Harvey. And we were still in the mix. So we were looking at potential flooding. And I had written a long article about these are the scenarios, and this is the information that you need to know. I had to pay then for that post to go out. They call it a boosted post. And they wanted me to pay $10 to them in order to put that on people's news feeds. There's six-ish thousand people who follow me. Maybe 1,000 saw that post. A $1 billion company held information that is important and mm-hmm. necessary held that information hostage for $10.
Wow.
And they rake in billions. That is my tangent. I have been furious about it mm-hmm. since it happened. But that goes to show you can click on someone's page and find the posts there. But like any portfolio or anything, you have to diversify where you get your information. And plug for local TV here. We go on every morning and every afternoon. We have that information up. That information is on our website. If it's not us, other stations, we're not the only local news station. All across the country, they have that information. The National Weather Service, they put their discussions out mm-hmm. twice a day, more if needed. Even these specialized agencies, National Hurricane Center, with their discussions. There's a lot of places. There's a lot of trustworthy places to get these posts. Facebook has it there. They also have a lot of other stuff.
But it's up to you to find it.
Right. And then up to you to also verify and make sure that's a good site. I know a lot of guys who write weather blogs, and their information is great, trustworthy. But, Jim Bob's blog, Jim Bob's weather blog, may not be as mm-hmm. great as you think it is, or he thinks it is even. And so just be careful. And I don't want to discourage anyone from having their weather blog, but make sure that that's not the only source of information.
Right. Well, you bring up a good thing about, going local. I mean, when you watch the national media, CNN, Weather Channel, all Fox, everything that's out there, and when they're covering severe weather and hurricanes like that, it's great TV. It really is. It's entertainment for the most part. But you have to think that these guys that are coming in and reporting, they're sweeping in, they do their reports as the hurricane's going, and then boom, they're off to the next story, kind of leaving us. But you and I, we live here. Rob, a good example, was affected by the flood of 2016, out of his house for almost a year. But the longer that you live in a certain area, A, you're going to care more about it for sure, and B, you're going to know the geography of this area and how systems are going to affect us. That just like Florence was different, you have the Appalachian Mountains, which changes the whole dynamics of how it's going to affect that geographical area. We don't have that. Storm surge is a completely different here than what it may be in the Florida Panhandle. So would you encourage people to stay with the local affiliates, whether it's us or anybody else here?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's a good point. And I put a lot of Florence articles out. I wrote a long one every day leading up to landfall with the impacts. But I can't tell you what the Wilmington coastline looks like. I don't mm-hmm. know how those bays interact or how the rivers interact. I don't know where the topography starts going up. I can't tell you how the Vermilion Bay reacts. I can tell you that the Vermilion River flows north when it gets too full. I know where communities are. So if I should not be the only place that you get your information from mm-hmm. for Florence. And that's a bit of an extreme because they're far away. But Michael, people could have evacuated here to Louisiana
sure.
and looking at me to give them information. I can give them the best I can, but you have to stay tuned to your local people. And I would hope that if someone evacuated Lafayette, that instead of reading Little Rock's news or the mm-hmm. Associated Press or the Weather Channel, that they would be able to come to us and say, okay, well, I know that my house is here, and they're talking about Highway 190, Highway 90, or wherever it is, and I know where my house is located to that, so I'm mm-hmm. okay, or oh my God, I hope everything's all right when I get back.
And that's such a cool thing living in the 21st century. The internet allows you to do that, where if you did evacuate 25 years ago, you had to depend on national media to get the information. Today, you can use an app on your phone, and you can watch the local coverage. And that's kind of where we're going to end it here, because that's one of the things that we want to, tell you. Stay with your local media. And we're not talking about just hurricane season. We got severe weather season that's happening mm-hmm. now. We've got winter weather that may come and play with us later on this year or early next year. Severe weather season comes back again during the spring. And then, of course, you got hurricane season 2019 that will be coming on. So, of course, you can follow KATC, our Facebook page, our Twitter feeds, KATC.com. You've got the mobile app. We got local radar.
Yeah, a lot of places to find it.
It's a lot of great stuff. And again, when it does come to a time period where it's an emergency situation, yes, we do appreciate that you trust us at KATC. But you know what? There's a lot of other sources that are local too. Feel free. Check them out. Get the best story that you can by mixing all of the different stories getting the best picture you can. Daniel, it was a great talk. We're looking forward to, the new year. And, of course, we will be ready for hurricane season 2019. I'm Dave Baker. Thanks to meteorologist Daniel Phillips. We hope you enjoyed the talk.